think Bon Jovi started out as a rock band and they became a pop band and they retained the rock and roll feel.
Oh, they liked that, did they? Bit uncool.
Their music was so hot, it would melt rock.
There is quite a bit of snobbery about Bon Jovi, I suppose, among certain rock fans that think they're a bit above humming along with a damn good tune, you know, but they always have the last laugh. It doesn't matter, it doesn't touch them, it doesn't affect them.
I mean, you don't join a rock band because you want to be, you know, part of the Christian Union or the Salvation Army. You don't generally join a rock and roll band in New Jersey because you're a glass of white wine with a meal and an early night kind of a dude. With the fame comes money. With the money and the fame come chicks. With the chicks come drug dealers. With the drug dealers come one long party that can literally last months and months and months and years and years and years.
The name of Bon Jovi is really synonymous with New Jersey, every bit as much as Bruce Springsteen's name. From the very earliest days, it was very important to them that they expressed their background as New Jersey band, and it was very much a part of how they presented themselves to the public.
I think you could tell Bon Jovi came from New Jersey in the early days, particularly. There's something extremely loud and obnoxious about New Yorkers, which you have to be another New Yorker to really love. But the boys from New Jersey, they tended to dress down, look slightly more like Bruce Springsteen and less like Joey Ramone.
Certainly there is something extremely identifiable about Bon Jovi's roots in New Jersey, because you can't really talk about that state without talking about New York itself, because the Garden State, as it's called, is really looked at as the dumping ground of New York, which is the place where the bright lights and big city are. Whereas New Jersey is working class, it's lower, it's suburban, and that's no one really important comes from there. It's a terrible stereotype, but it's something that I'm sure Bon Jovi have reacted against from their earliest days. And that's what really defines them as a band, is the fact that they've overcome the kind of mundane identity that is associated with people from New Jersey and become bigger than anyone from New York ever could.
Bon Jovi came out of this New Jersey scene, which certainly had an influence on them, particularly Bruce Springsteen and Southside Johnny. In fact, John Bon Jovi would mention Southside Johnny before he'd talk about Bruce Springsteen back in those days, which might be rather surprising, but there was that huge scene on the Jersey Shore.
Well, John Bon Jovi was born and brought up in New Jersey, as was David Bryan. Now, they're both the same age. They were both born in 1962. John had several groups growing up. Probably the most famous was Atlantic City Expressway. Tico, sort of 9 years older than John, he had a big background in session work and touring bands, and he was signed to RCA with a group called Frankie and the Knockouts. Alec John Such was 10 years older than John when the group started out. In fact, well, he's probably still 10 years older than John. And he had a background in session work too, and he played in lots of covers bands around New Jersey. And Richie Sambora, also New Jersey born and bred, 3 years older than John. He had a group called Mercy, which was at one time signed to Led Zeppelin's Swan Song label, which was very apt because he was a massive Jimmy Page fan. And he had another few bands as well. And when he first saw Bon Jovi, who at that time had Dave Sabo, called Snake, who later went on to form Skid Row. He was the first Bon Jovi guitarist. Richie Sambora turned up in Chicago to see them play and went up and told John that he had the wrong guitarist and that he, Richie, should take the job, and that's how he joined. So they all came together like that. On the street where you live, girls talk about the social lives. They made a lipstick, plastic, and paint. Don't you see when they rise? All your life, all your past, when's your daddy gonna talk to you? But you would
In the very early days, John received a lot of support from his family, his uncle Tony Bon Jovi, who was one of the owners of the Power Station Studios in New York. John got like a summer job there as a gopher, go make the coffee, sweep the floors, as a kid. So he got to see a lot of top musicians working close up. He also later on got to demo songs during downtime, those hours when regular artists weren't using the studio, usually literally in the middle of the night.
So he built up a little stack of demos of his own music. And when Tony Bon Jovi heard Runaway, he realized that that was a, you know, for the first time, this was a really great song, really great composition, and got a team of studio musicians together to record it with John. And the demo was sent out all over the place, and really with very little reaction.
Like I was saying, it's very difficult to get a record deal, and most A&R guys are afraid to sign or take a chance on a young band. And especially without representation or a history behind you, I went to a radio station because I thought, who sits in a room by himself with a microphone, does what he loves to do, which is spin records, yeah, and talk into this mic?
The DJ.
Well, it was a DJ. And I went in and I said, you know, look, if it stinks, just tell me, but I'm really frustrated at this point. Listen to this song, Runaway. And he did, and he liked it enough and begged me to put it on this homegrown album that the radio station was putting on. There were a brand new station out of New York that's now defunct called WAPP. And a DJ named Chip Hobart there. And
but you know, I remember that station when I lived there 20 years ago.
It was there for a short period of time. It's now a country station. It was 103.5 on the dial out there. But by my saying, okay, why not? You know, it wasn't what you ever aspired to do when you're a kid, you see. I'm going to get a record deal. Well, you think album. You don't think single. You don't think one cut on a local record. Okay, we'll see what happens. The fluke was, it was New York City, and I was getting airplay in New York City without a record deal or a manager or even a band at that point. And then the station was owned by a chain, and that chain picked up the song. And now it was causing a bit of a
sure, because now you're
phenomena.
In a number of cities across the country. You're
and
going national
the competition
now,
is saying, where'd that song? Who is that? How is that? And record companies then turned around and paid attention, and in 1983, fortunately, I got a record deal.
Yeah.
She's a little runaway.
The fact is, which they've never hidden or felt any shame about, is that Bon Jovi himself, John, he was signed to the record company. The band were not. The band were John's employees from the start. So they were a band of guys who John pulled together to back him. So that was always the truth. And that they didn't have any gripes about that, as far as I'm aware.
Once he'd got his record deal and the Bon Jovi band together, his whole career then moved on to another level. He had a manager called Doc McGee, who came in, very experienced New York, smart operator, had a history in the music business, knew what he was doing. Nevertheless, it was a very, very long struggle.
The first Bon Jovi album, they were really a perfectly proficient rock band, maybe verging a little towards A&R in some parts and towards rock and roll in other parts. But, you know, some of the material was really quite ordinary. They were still finding their feet. They were still looking for the wow factor.
Well, I mean, I think everything else that's on the debut is just, it's just like a much more straight ahead kind of rock album. But Runaway is obviously a different songwriter. I mean, you definitely get a strong sense that Bon Jovi were, you know, in a studio and just figuring out what works, you know, and just like what they can do as a band, whereas Runaway obviously had composition that took place elsewhere.
I think the first Bon Jovi album, really, the standout track is always going to be Runaway. It was the first single, the first video. It was what made them big in Japan before they got big everywhere else. It was the one that the girls really liked as well. And in a strange way, that kind of embarrassed them somewhat, because the success of Runaway threatened to turn them into a pop group. And at that stage, John in particular was very keen that they should be taken seriously as a rock group.
This town, girl,
I think it was a good predictor of the cliches that were going to be ever present throughout all of Bon Jovi's discography. Of course, there's an extremely heavy emphasis on melody, writing the killer hook, writing something that's going to be kind of lapped up by the radio listening public and so on, but it wasn't quite there yet. It wasn't refined because they weren't really secure in their identity as a commercial band, which is what they would certainly become much later. They were much more derivative of other things that were happening at the time, and certainly there weren't the sort of foreigner influences that you hear in some of the later albums.
Well, with this album, Runaway was a top 40 hit in America, which was brilliant for a debut single. The album itself, it settled just outside the top 40 in America, got to number 71 in this country. So that was very, very encouraging indeed for the band and for the record company. So there were great hopes for the next album. In terms of touring, Bon Jovi did a lot of support tours, and they kept on doing support tours right up to the point of Slippery When Wet coming out. When that came out, they were actually on another support tour. They toured with the Scorpions. The one place where they did break through really, really big with the debut album was Japan. And as a result of their reception in Japan, they opened their 7,800 degrees Fahrenheit world tour there.
Oh, it's just genius. It's so stupid. It's absolute genius.
The second album was rather hilariously called 7,800 degrees Fahrenheit, which is a hell of a mouthful for any kid to say when they walk in the record store. The whole idea is that that's the temperature at which rock melts. The idea being that, you know, their music was so hot, it would melt rock.
You have to wonder, because this is the days before Google, it's before Wikipedia, how did anyone associated with the band or in the band know that the temperature at which you can melt stone is 7,800 degrees Fahrenheit? It's completely bizarre. So someone must have had a geology book laying around, which is just boggles the mind to know that. So of course the implication of that is that, oh, it's hot rock, isn't it? But I don't think the fans would necessarily get that. And really the story isn't that interesting if that is what the explanation is. It's the only one that I think anyone's come up with.
John, who was and is, but particularly in those days, an extremely pretty young man, really, really wanted to downplay the whole thing, really, really wanted to emphasize that Bon Jovi was a proper rock band. It was five guys, this big gang together. They weren't going to trade on his looks. They were going to prove that they could go out and kick ass. And so that whole album, you know, there would be no Runaway, no big cutesy ballads. It would be all about ballsy, kick-ass rock. And that's pretty much what it was. The only trouble was it failed miserably.
I think it's certainly a low point for the band, you know, just both in terms of the songwriting, the material just wasn't there. And I think that they were trying to get a bit deep. I mean, we're talking about, with 7,800, Bon Jovi before they were really Bon Jovi. You know, we're still talking about the seeds of the band that would later become the global icons, you know, the kind of housewives dream kind of band that they later became. So you don't really see the refined Bon Jovi, the kind of self-aware Bon Jovi that knows what they're doing and has the confidence to write an album like New Jersey or Slippery When Wet. I mean, that was yet to come. Simply, they had promise, but they weren't really there.
A couple of reasons Bon Jovi were big in Japan before everywhere else. Runaway was the first reason. John's looks were the second reason. Japanese girls love cute Western pop stars, and they don't come much cuter than John Bon Jovi back in 1983 or 84.
Something that I wonder about their success in Japan is just exactly, you know, how to make sense of it. I mean, you don't get the sense that rock fans are the same in Japan as they are elsewhere. There's almost a weird kind of fetishization of rock stars, you know, an idolization that doesn't necessarily occur elsewhere, I mean, you look at the audiences and so on, and these people do not look like rock fans. They're not part of the same team.
I think Tokyo Road, I mean, the lyrics are a little bit ambiguous, actually, but I think it was probably inspired by their experiences touring in Japan. Probably the heart of the song is the red light passage, which is where the sort of thunderous rock sound disappears to be replaced with all sorts of atmospheric noises. And then, of course, the band burst back in to gallop onto the last post. But it's an interesting song, probably works better live than it does on the record, really. It's a very good live song, and it survived into the set for quite a long time.
I think Tokyo Road is a brilliant song. It's instantly recognizable, and obviously the bridge goes on forever, which is ideal for a band that really kind of, their cash cow is the live stage. You know, and that's what Bon Jovi were. They were brilliant sellout headliners, and that's the kind of song you can extend for 30 minutes if you want to, because it's written in a way where it doesn't even go into psychedelia. It's just repetition. And if you listen to that bass line, you're talking about like almost zen-like stamina, you know, just hitting the same string over and over and over and over again. So you have to wonder how many times you had to rehearse that. Probably once.
I think when you look at the second album, pretty much you have to bear in mind at every turn, here is a group desperately trying to be taken seriously. You don't get taken seriously by singing la la la, I love you, you love me, oh how happy we will be. You get taken seriously trying to be Bruce Springsteen doing Darkness on the Edge of Town. And that's kind of what they were trying to do, that tackle the big issues, prove they were serious, have something serious to say about this bad old world and this tough old life and how they feel it deep down inside. And I know I sound sarcastic, but you know, 23-year-old boys trying to write seriously about life, that's what you're going to get. They didn't really grab the bull by the horns until Slippery When Wet, when they did have professional songwriters come in and kind of slap them into shape and say, guys, this is really tedious, we got to get some big choruses together here, get some serious songs going, or people are just not going to buy this album either and your career is over.
I'm quite sure there was an element of desperation in the way they approached that album. On the whole, a productive desperation that you can hear in that, the craving to make this work, to get across to people, to succeed, whether most artists will say, and I really do believe them on the whole. Most artists will say they're not motivated by money, the riches side of what might be achieved, but they are motivated by wanting to get their music across and reach those people, and the money is a very pleasant side effect.
I remember one record company executive telling me at the time, as always, certain record company executives will, claiming that he'd saved their recording career by sending a memo out to the chiefs at their record company explaining that so far they'd got it entirely wrong with Bon Jovi. They were treating them like a heavy metal band. They weren't a heavy metal band. The crucial point was they were a pop group dressed as a heavy metal band. And if they could get their heads around that idea, start promoting the idea that they've got this amazingly good-looking guy at the front of the group and give them some songs that people could remember longer than 5 minutes, they might have a hit.
I think they basically, when the kind of hammer was put down on Bon Jovi, certainly they were kind of at a fork in the road, and they had to ask themselves, you know, what are we going to do? Are we going to stick to what we really love doing, or are we just going to try and keep the band together and become successful? You've got to consider Bon Jovi himself. John Bon Jovi sang on a Christmas-themed record based on Star Wars and dedicated it to R2-D2. You're not talking about someone who's, you know, kind of really out to kind of defy the world with his artistic statements or anything like that. So I imagine that conversation probably lasted about 2 minutes, if that.
I think Bon Jovi were probably under pressure from the record company to increase their record sales with their third album and certainly get a couple of hit singles if they could. They went to Vancouver to record this album, and they brought in a producer called Bruce Fairbairn, who had done Blue Oyster Cult and people like that, but he wasn't yet the big name he later would be. They also brought in a songwriter called Desmond Child, and he collaborated on 3 songs with John and Richie. 2 of them were singles, You Give Love a Bad Name and Livin' on a Prayer, and the third was Without Love. And both of these people actually saw the potential of the group for absolutely fantastic melodic rock music, the commercial possibilities of it, and probably lightened things up a bit, I would imagine.
I think certainly 7800's lukewarm reception was something that that really kind of spawned their later success, or would have led to their complete failure, because yeah, this was the 80s, and the music industry was changing at that time. You know, studios were changing, and they were not willing to invest in artists. And of course, it's absolutely heinous when you compare that to what's going on in the 70s, but it's even worse now, where you just basically have to score a hit with your first one. So I think Bon Jovi's experience with 7800 was certainly something that, you know, was just kind of there's something prophetic about that they were already getting that pressure on their second album, because realistically they shouldn't have been writing their best songs by that time anyway, that they should have still had them in them, but that's not what people were after.
There's a saying in the music business: art for art's sake, hit singles for fuck's sake.
As to how Slippery When Wet got its title, I understand that there are some rude stories out there, but I don't know them. I mean, it sounds sexy, doesn't it? And yet, all I've ever heard is about this road sign in Vancouver where they recorded the album. And there was a sign on the corner of the road saying Slippery When Wet, and they thought, that's a good phrase, we'll call our album that. I'm sure that's true, and anything else is a figment of very bad people's imaginations. But I'm prepared to hear the stories if you want to tell me.
Well, it's an interesting thing about Slippery When Wet, you know, because there's something so deeply misogynistic about the entire album. I mean, of course, 80s America was extremely sensitive. I mean, this is the era of Reagan. It's the era of you know, just very, very strong republicanism, and you know, the rebirth of conservative values after the 70s. And Bon Jovi, in a way, kind of summed up a lot of what that was all about, which is basically, we're not talking about you know, feminism or whatever, but the PMRC was extremely active at that time as well. And weren't happy at all about the gigantic breasts that were going to make the cover of that album. And so the band relented, because they are not the Dead Kennedys. You know, they didn't exactly go up against Tipper Gore and the conservative American government. They said, okay, we'll just have a trash bag that's wetted and just kind of like write the title into it, which is not really the bold artistic statement that they might have made, but I don't think anyone was expecting them to anyway. You Give Love a Bad Name, obviously, was the first single, in fact, not Living on a Prayer. So that's what they hit people with.
and I suppose it's a grittier song, it's a harder rocking song, and it's really aggressive. But I think it's a very natural song. It's not anti-women, it's not sexist, it's a proper hate-love song, love-hate song, hate-love. Because they bust up, and it takes its revenge, very nicely, I'd say, as in nastily, just because it's so strong. And here he is insulting this woman, whether it's a real person or not, or whether it's, obviously it becomes generic in the song, it just becomes what everybody's familiar with. Of course it's from the male point of view, but I think women can relate to it too, as in all that bitch, she treated him wrong.
Quite a lot of people have said that particularly Desmond Child was almost single-handedly responsible for the success of Slippery When Wet, but I think that's overstating the case a bit, and he was only on, you know, he only co-wrote three tracks.
It didn't have a massive reputation by then, but he was a sort of a song doctor. There was a whole cluster of song doctors came up in the 80s, people whose function was to work with people, with songwriters who already had something on the go but couldn't quite hit the spot for massive popularity. And so they went to see him just for three tracks on this album, so it's not like he's a dominant influence and he's only a co-writer of the three tracks, but there he is. He co-wrote the first two hit singles.
The band had a very good idea by now of where they were going. They'd established what their strengths were. Hopefully they'd established what their weaknesses were. And they went on without Desmond Child to write some fantastic songs and fantastic albums that were still selling in the millions.
In terms of how Slippery When Wet made the breakthrough, what you see if you read back into the publications of the time, magazines around about that time, is that it is seen as an album that was propelled by video.
The relationship with MTV really, really took off with Slippery When Wet, because they had those massive singles, You Give Love a Bad Name and Livin' on a Prayer. And they had a marvelous relationship with MTV. Obviously, they were a very visual group, and so they were perfect broadcasting material.
See, when I grew up in New Jersey, we had a couple of buddies of mine that used to think we were going to rule the universe.
Well, there's something about Bon Jovi doing Livin' on a Prayer acoustically that completely changes the dynamic of that song. When you listen to the original version, it's brimming with a kind of optimism, and you're sure that prayer is going to get answered. You know, there's something about the acoustic version that's kind of got us sort of sitting in a dive bar at 5 in the morning knocking back your 20th whiskey. Pretty sure the prayer isn't going to get answered. It kind of changes the mood into a kind of glasses half empty sort of song, and that's not the way it was originally written, but it says something about the musicianship of the band that they could transform that song so totally by conveying it in an acoustic way, just a little slowed down, a little subtler, and it became something almost poetic. Johnny used to work on the docks. Union been on strike. It's down on its luck. It's dead. Shooting with. And Gina works in time all day. She's looking for a man. She brings home a baby.
Living on a Prayer acoustically, I think, did two things. Number one, it proved that old adage that, you know, the best songs can always are the ones that always come over when you just strip them down to their absolute basic elements. It's like Travis doing Hit Me Baby One More Time. You can play that on an acoustic guitar, it still sounds great. It doesn't have to be Britney in the big production to make it sound great. Living on a Prayer, same thing. It's just a great song. You know, it could have been a Beatles song. You know, it's just a great, catchy song, whoever does it and however you do it. I think the other thing it did for Bon Jovi was, in that kind of pre-unplugged age, it demonstrated, a bit like the Dominion gig had demonstrated 5 years before, that they actually didn't need all the razzmatazz. You could take all that away, and these two guys actually can deliver. You know, if they were in this room right now with an acoustic guitar, they would be able to sing just as well as you hear on record, play just as well, and the stuff would come over, and you'd have to applaud at the end of it, because they are the real deal.
Living on a Prayer has that strong structure, great chorus, loads of power behind it, of course. But there's a couple of things that happen in there that are interesting. One of which I think is absolutely grotesque. That intro, where that strange voice, that fuzzboxed voice comes in going, wah, 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 or whatever the hell it is, making those weird noises. What were they thinking of when they put that in? What an atrocity that is. How did that song survive that production feature and become a hit? I mean, it's just so weird. It sounds like it's going to be a comic song, doesn't it? What are they doing? Does anybody like that? Why haven't they stripped it out? Why didn't they strip it out before they released it? You know. So there's a weirdness about it. Song opens with very peculiar noise, and still people carry on listening. She says we gotta hold on to what we got. But then in terms of the writing, and here again, you don't know if this is old Desmond at work, Desmond Child, or whether it's Bon Jovi realising, hey, this is how we do it. There's that key change towards the end. Now, what ought to be happening to that song is it ought to be going into, well, they always say on the lyric sheets on albums, repeat to fade. And repeat to fade is not a very inspiring thought, is it? Can be, can work very well. However, what you get at that point is that after what might have been the last chorus or the repeat to fade, you get that key change and you go up and you're soaring into the finish instead of fading into the finish. And you know, that was another thing. It's not an entirely original device by any means, but for sure it works there. It does exactly what that song is primarily about, which is being uplifting in the most literal sense. It goes up and it takes you with it, and you're there hollering in the shower or in the crowd watching them, you know. You're just singing along and it's wonderful. Nobody could object to that. Everybody can enjoy that, I think, more or less. We'll be right back.
think it's really difficult to say whether Jon Bon Jovi can't write really deep lyrics, or if he just doesn't want to. I mean, you kind of think about just like how it works with the music and so on. And you know, Wanted Dead or Alive, for instance, is a great example of narrative in lyrics and so on, where you do get this really strong sense of a character and a story and things taking place and this and that. And so he is really talented in that sense, you know, but you wouldn't strip the lyrics away from the music and probably want to recite them as you might with other artists.
I think John takes huge inspiration from people like Bruce Springsteen, but I think trying to be the new Bruce Springsteen is as futile as Bruce Springsteen trying to be the new Bob Dylan. You just have to be who you are, and I think, in fairness to Jon Bon Jovi, he reconciled himself to that a long, long time ago. I think the fact of the matter is that he's always been a cut above your average rock lyricist. He does know how to tell a story. Clearly, he doesn't rely on all the cliches. John really does hark back to more the Rod Stewart, Elton John kind of era. And I think, yeah, he does. He hits that level consistently enough to be taken seriously.
Loads to Bon Jovi. He co-writes a lot of the best songs with John, obviously. He's a wonderful character. He was very much involved with the pin-up appeal of the group to begin with, but a very underestimated guitar player, I think. His guitar playing is fantastic. If you listen to the first Bon Jovi album, there's a lot of Richie going wild on guitar on that. He plays acoustic, electric, 6-string, 12-string, guitar synths, riffs, solos, power chords, whatever you want, Richie plays it. But at heart, he's actually a blues guitar player, and so when it came to doing his solo albums, I think that quite a lot of what Richie was brought up with is evident on those.
Well, it's interesting about Richie Sambora because Eddie Van Halen gets a huge amount of credit in the 80s. Obviously, he defined a style of guitar playing, but a lot of things that Richie Sambora were doing were just a little more subtle, a little less showboaty, but extremely effective. I think that's the trademark of a good musician as opposed to a really good performer. And that's one of the things about him that I think kind of defines what he does, and especially even with his solo albums. You know, is that I think he is the sort of guy who likes to sit in the studio and, you know, fiddle with knobs and kind of get the right sound, as opposed to just sort of be the man in the spotlight. Wanted Dead or Alive is one of the most amazingly written songs ever. It's properly composed, and that is all down to Richie Sambora's style of guitar playing, where you've got to consider his career. I mean, he was signed to Led Zeppelin's label Swan Song in the 70s. I mean, the guy knew what he was doing if he caught the attention of Jimmy Page. So if he wanted to add a spaghetti western kind of atmosphere to a song, he was the sort of person who could do that. And that kind of tinkling guitar in the beginning is unforgettable. It's riveting, and it conveys this kind of cinematic feel that makes you feel as though you are almost watching a movie. You can see the cowboy, you know what's going on with him, and it just kind of conveys the story in a way that the lyrics don't necessarily.
It's all a dream.
woman needs a change every day. It seems rare, we're still away.
I think Wanted Dead or Alive works really well, first of all, because it's a very good song. It's extremely memorable, very catchy. You don't have to be a rock fan to like it. But if you are a rock fan, of course, it does have these extra layers, you know, On a Steel Horse I Ride, the motorbike, the whole, you know, allusions to touring, the whole thing about, you know, that cowboy thing of rock and roll, where you turn up in town and kiss all the women and fight all the men, and by the morning you're gone on your steel horse. It works on a number of levels, and they do it extremely, you know, at face value. They're very, very straight-faced. There's no joke or irony in there.
I'm a cowboy on a steel horse. I'm running.
I think Wanted Dead or Alive is almost like their mini anthem, because they did write it together. It really does sum up how they felt about the whole rock and roll experience at that point. And they still do it live to this day. It's a big, big moment in the show. And for some reason, whether you find the lyrics corny or not, it does send that tingle down the spine. It's got something.
Wanted Dead or Alive is probably Bon Jovi's signature song. It's not my personal favourite, I must admit, but people love it and they play it wherever they go, and it's just immediately identifiable Bon Jovi. It's the whole saga of life on the road. Despite the fact that it's such a popular song, it's actually quite a despairing song if you listen to the lyrics. It's by no means the heroic cowboy riding into town on his steel horse. It's actually a very searching, very depressed song in many ways, but the way that it's presented is kind of akin to like a Sergio Leone film. It's got that kind of Wild West feel about Richie's guitar playing, which is very intricate, very fitting to the song, him and John, the dynamic duo. And at the end then Richie gets the chance to do some full-blooded guitar work too, so it's a really good collaboration.
Wanted Dead or Alive, I think, is an example of how their writing could have a degree of range. Their writing wasn't all going in one direction, and yet their performance was. Because although that was a hit single, not a great hit, but it was a hit single, to me that's really quite a poor track. And it's because they don't bring out what that song may have, and they just, perhaps the song is really crass. You can easily feel that it is crass. The chorus, I'm a cowboy on a steel horse I ride, I'm wanted dead or alive. Actually, when you come, the more you think about it, any time I come back to that chorus, it does seem pretty naff to me. It is what the bad end of this kind of rock music is, when it starts to get self-aggrandizing, when the lyrics and the arrangement and the whole thing starts to puff up the artist, and it just becomes an exercise in chest beating. And I do think that that's probably a track where that did happen. I mean, maybe that song was rescuable. Maybe He probably have had to rewrite the chorus, though. I don't think that chorus is salvageable. But the idea of the itinerant musician, the troubadour, as the gunslinging cowboy, I mean, you can see where it comes from, and it's not illogical, it's just crap. That's the problem, you know. It is self-aggrandizing. He is a guy with a guitar on his back, as one of the verses says. He isn't a guy with a six gun on his waist. He's not going around to kill people. He's going around the world to entertain people. And those are rather different functions. So essentially, this song is rather ill-conceived. And though the verses, I think, are quite good, and a better chorus might have been written, it is one of those songs on Slippery When Wet where the band crushes the song underfoot and they lose themselves, really. They do lose themselves.
The poodle haircuts, hair rock music. Well, that had been something that was evolving quite naturally, really. See, it's easy to look back now and laugh at all that. But in the 80s, that was a very cool way to look in certain rock circles, you see. Probably it may have started with bands like the New York Dolls, kind of crossed over to Europe via groups like Hanoi Rocks. And then it was kind of purloined from Hanoi Rocks and taken back to America, where it kind of materialized in groups like Motley Crue, Poison, Guns N' Roses.
I don't think Bon Jovi exactly have the biggest hairdo, certainly the most preened. I mean, you definitely get a sense that Bon Jovi is a man who might look in the mirror more than once before he leaves the house. But the whole idea of hair metal is obviously a bit of a misnomer. You know, it repeats none of the ethos of metal itself. I mean, in a way, it is metal for people who don't like metal, you know, who want to feel as though they are going to metal concerts and listening to metal records, because it's completely non-threatening and stripped of any of the kind of working class origins that really define those kinds of bands.
I think that look, the poodle look, was kind of restricted to the stars up to a point, because those hairdos and the dye jobs they had, streaks and all that caper, like in Botham here, I remember the cricketer having it here. They were pretty elaborate and rather expensive and time-consuming. And then rude British lads would probably call you a pufta, which was a bad thing to be called back in those days. And so I think that there was a degree of crossover, but when I see pictures of Bon Jovi fans, at least Bon Jovi's British fans back in those days, they looked like heavy metal fans had been looking for, oh, up to 20 years.
I think because they are obsessed themselves. You know, John, I think the curse of being the amazingly good-looking young man is that you want to be taken seriously. And there's a lot of snobbery in rock music, particularly 20 years ago, where, you know, Lemmy from Motorhead, well, he's clearly serious because the man's as ugly as a hog and you know, and he's obviously not just pandering to the girls, he's the real deal, he's a biker, you know. He's not, by the way, he just looks like one. You know, Ozzy Osbourne, I mean, this is not someone who's going to be in the boy band, you know. This is, particularly in Black Sabbath days, you know, these guys weren't designed to be pinned up on some 13-year-old girl's wall. John Bon Jovi, on the other hand, you know, is Robbie Williams 20 years before. He could easily have been in Take That with the right haircut. He could easily have been in the Bay City Rollers before that. He could easily be in Pop Idol right now and do real well. And for him, that's an issue. I think less so these days, but in the early days when he was still out there building empires and proving he had talent, the message was implicit. Yeah, I'm really good looking, and yes, girls love me, and I probably don't have to try very hard. But in fact, I do try hard. I can really sing, I can really write songs, I can play guitar, and here's the proof. There's more to me than meets the eye.
suppose Slippery When Wet is a classic rock album, as in there's a whole generation of people who will remember it very fondly. That's one way of being a classic rock album. However, what that does say, I think, is that when that generation of people dies, I suppose, or that when their fondness for the music of their youth fades away, if it ever does, that's it. That's the last memorial to Bon Jovi, I think. I don't believe that, unlike, say, Dylan, who was one of his original inspirations, or I would imagine Bruce Springsteen, I don't think that Bon Jovi's music will carry on capturing new generations of fans. Much as it has some very, very strong qualities, it does lack substance, really.
No, I think Slippery When Wet is the defining moment of Bon Jovi. I mean, it is them hitting their peak, which they might have been able to sustain somewhat with New Jersey, which certainly had its hits, and platinum albums are nothing to sniff at. But Slippery When Wet just hit the struck when the iron was hot. You know, the radio stations were ready to play that kind of album to death. People were ready to listen to it to death, and it's really easy to see why, because it is the sound of a band fully realized.
I think, to their credit, unlike so many groups of the 80s, from Duran Duran onwards, really, here's a group that made it enormously successful in the mid to late 80s, and yet, you know, 15, 20 years later, they're just as big as they ever were. In fact, when we think of Bon Jovi, we tend not to think of those days anymore. We tend to think of the group as we see it now, the group that plays Wembley Stadium, the group that plays Dodgers Stadium in America, the group that is literally huge all over the world.
Slippery When Wet was maybe not the peak of their career, but definitely the golden era, because that was when the huge sudden impact of Bon Jovi spread smiles around the world. Everybody looks back on that period, and those singles are indelibly remembered. They're not just looking back on the music, they're looking back on a whole era, a whole lifestyle, when that music was kind of the backdrop to it. Bon Jovi actually went on to sell millions and millions and millions more records. New Jersey was a huge album. They're still making albums to this day that are selling in their millions and millions. I would say, you know, in terms of career peaks, there was a pretty big one in 2004 when they celebrated 100 million album sales. And they've probably put on a few more million since then. They're just unstoppable. They have not been tainted by changing fashions. They've kept the audiences they had, they keep adding more. They're one of those bands that don't go out of fashion because they just keep on doing what they do. People trust them in a funny way, and they just remain at the very, very top.
Bon Jovi certainly were uncool to a very high degree back in the 80s, and it's not something that their music is going to acquire in retrospect. So no, I think they never were cool, they never will be cool. But there again, that's such a nebulous thing to say, isn't it? You can't, it disrespects all those hundreds of thousands of people who enormously liked them. And it really is only that thing about some people being perceived as tastemakers, and what they say is uncool is uncool. No harm in that, I'd say. They're uncool, and who the hell cares about that? They don't care. Bon Jovi sure don't care. They know where they stand. They know they will be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame when they've done their 25 years. They know they've had a very strong career. I don't know where they rate their music in relation to the great artists who they've admired. I suppose they probably know they're more like Kiss than they are like Bruce Springsteen. Bon Jovi probably do know that. And I guess that's why, exactly, they would never be cool. And they would never be great either, but they certainly have been entertaining.